to give his address to the delegates. Pat guided two U.S. provinces through critical times in their history, the former Poughkeepsie province and now our U.S. province. And I often think that people cite his humor and his warm manner, but it's really his tremendous love of this way of life, I think, that inspires all of us to stay true to the dream of Marcel Champagne. So it's a real privilege to welcome Pat and to have him address us.
Look at me all verklempt before we start. Just so we're clear, this afternoon I really would like to just share some reflections with you and enter into a conversation with you. And tomorrow morning I'd ask the time as part of our business conversation to talk about some ideas about the government piece in the next provincial council. So I'm not going to be addressing that in this talk, so it's clear. Now when Ernesto spoke to us this morning, he spoke in beautiful English. He kept threatening he was going to switch to Mexican, but he was beautiful English. I said, this afternoon now you have to get used to me speaking in Pennsylvania. Good luck. I think you've read it up with Ernesto this morning. And as I begin, I first want to express my thanks sincerely, once again, for your asking me to be your provincial in the next 3 years. The past 3 years were really quite fun, you know, and engaging and challenging. And I really felt your support, your fraternity, and your presence with me throughout the 3 years. And even as myself and our team went around, I really always felt very welcome and very much at home with you, that this was our project, this was our province. And it wasn't really, someone said before, Ernesto said, Patrick, it's for you to do. No, I never believed that, and I don't still believe. This is really our project to do together. So again, I look to the next 3 years with the same type of thinking. And more, the hour seems to grow, doesn't it? Yeah. You know, we talked about 50 years ago, it would have been just our project. But now our project is much broader. Our project is much broader. And it's sometimes just trying to get all of us involved with the conversation is somewhat challenging. And we're going to talk about that this afternoon. When you arrived at your place this afternoon, and if you didn't happen to find it, you would have found a copy of the book Everyone Needs to Forgive Somebody by Alan Hunt. This is your first giveaway, so make sure you got one. And then we said this is the best part of the chapter. The giveaways start now. Between now and tomorrow morning, we'll have little gifts for you. I encountered this book at St. John Newman Church in Miami. I go there when I go to Miami often, I go with Michael Brady. And everyone in the parish received a copy of this book for their Lenten time of prayer with the intention that folks would share their ideas and forgiveness. It's one of those books is a story, and then there's some reflection questions, and you can even enter into group work. Now, Mike Brady gave me his copy. I kind of took it from him. And he forgave me for that. And I found it to be a very helpful read. And I thought, this would be good for us, too. On the back, he talks about forgiveness will unleash a power in your life that's underrated and often ignored. We fail to capture the power of forgiveness because we're afraid of it, because we've grown comfortable in our familiar wounds, or because we're just sinfully stubborn. But the power is there waiting for us. Everyone needs to forgive somebody. And I think even in the message of the 22nd general chapter, there's the beautiful description calling us to be the face and hands of tender mercy. Isn't that what forgiveness is about? It's only what calls. So I offer this book to you today. I think in our history as brothers and sisters, we can probably think of some hurts that we either consciously gave or maybe unconsciously received. So I think as we move toward Easter and begin this third century, forgiveness is a wonderful path to choose. So let me start. I ask your forgiveness if I or anyone in our administration offended you or ignored you in the past 3 years. Please forgive what we've done or what we haven't done. I also ask your forgiveness if you felt I haven't been a good leader with gospel example or challenge. Maybe not even your feeling, you saw evidence. He's not doing it. I speak for the leadership team as well. Forgive us if we've not called you the province to new life and mission for the church. Forgive us if our response to some of the needs and responsibilities of the USA province and the Marist world, and in fact even now the entire global family, have been inadequate or insufficient. Please forgive us. I join the message of the general chapter, a very significant message. Marist Brothers condemn any form of abuse of children and young people and vulnerable adults, emotional, physical, or sexual. And like the general chapter, we, the United States province, acknowledge the pain and suffering caused to victims by some members of our Marist institutions. We apologize to you for the hurt that these acts have caused. We know that your lives have been damaged and that this suffering has been shared with family and loved ones. Any abuse is a betrayal of the noble ideals of our founder, St. Marcel Chapagne. We apologize. Be assured that we support the work that's been done in the Marist Institute in recent years to protect children in our various schools, institutions, and ministries, to require all parts of the Marist world to implement child protection programs, and to provide training and awareness to prevent child abuse from ever happening again in our institutions. Lastly, I ask your forgiveness if this talk is too long. We Marists of Chapagne are now called to use all the power, positive energy, and resources that we have in the time that's given to us. Ernesto led us wonderfully through the quote today, to be transformed and sent as a global charismatic family, to be a beacon of hope in this turbulent world, to be bridge builders, to respond boldly to the needs of children and young people. So, in 1998, oh my God, I'm so much younger looking then. Some of us look different then. The leadership used to look a lot different. I addressed the Poughkeepsie Provincial Chapter as I started my second term as a provincial. In that talk, which was in Lawrence, Massachusetts, I spoke for about 20 minutes. And at the end of it, there was no response. It was weird. No smiles, no tears, no claps, no jeers, not even sleeping. Tom Long, the chair, asked, any questions? And there were none. So I'm curious to see what's going to happen today. At that time, I told a story from a hero of ours, Anthony DeMello. Anthony tells a story. There was a message from the pilot to the passengers in mid-flight. I regret to inform you that we are in terrible trouble. Only God can save us now. A passenger turned to a priest sitting next to her and asked, what had the pilot said? And the priest replied, he says there's no hope. Well, that was 20 years ago. And at that time, I used that story as an analogy for what a lot of people said about our province, that we were in terrible trouble. And there were some who said, there's no hope. And yes, God did come to help us. You know what? Our plane didn't crash. Sure, we had some terrible things happen in the past 20 years. 9/11, talking about plane crashes. The loss and sickness of many brothers and faculty members and colleagues and family members. We've had some awful political and religious situations that we've had to deal with. All true, past 20 years. But we Marist Brothers in the United States didn't lose hope. And I suggest that we always have felt that God has been very much present to us, never abandoned us. Just think, God shaped us into a new USA province. Marcel Champagne became Saint Marcel Champagne. We were called to choose life. And not only that, one of our own was chosen to be Superior General, a first. God nurtured our relationship with our lay Marist partners. God called us into a new land and shaped us into a new beginning. And even with all of that, and most importantly, haven't we had marvelous companions over these years? Great brothers, great friends, great students, encounters, Marist youth assemblies, province retreats, assemblies, and so much more. God has been good to us. So thanks to all of you who have been pilots of the plane during these years. Thanks to our past provincial leaders who are here today, except for poor Ben. And many of you who have been so significant to the province and community and ministry leadership. My special thanks to Dan, Al, Sean, Don, Owen, and Hank, who have spent the past 3 years helping me to navigate this province. I also at this point want to thank our local directors, now called community leaders, for the excellent care of the brothers in your homes. I want to start with thanking Dan, who's been superior in his efforts to provide continued excellent care for our senior brothers, especially those who have been infirmed. And in the past 3 years also, I want to thank Maria and Sue and Lorraine and Pat and our partners in healthcare, and all the local aides and support people. You've been incredible and very generous and caring. Often in interviews and community meetings, I've heard it said, and we heard it this morning again, this is not the order I joined. No, it's not. No, and as Ernesto said, it is not going to be. We face the reality that most of the fantasy and dream that we had while growing up of what life and work would be like as Marist Brothers of the United States and our ministries, most of those dreams will probably never happen. But we've discovered different realities, different calls. But even in this, I still think we might be men and women in terrible trouble, with the hope that only God can save us. Our terrible trouble lies in the belief and trust that we can do it alone, as a nation, as a church, as a religious family. Too often we embrace isolation, independence, instead of community and interdependence. Our terrible trouble lies in a world where most women, men and women are terribly poor, and we are not. Our terrible trouble lies in a world where most women, men and women struggle for their daily bread. What are these brothers and sisters trying to tell us? So today, this chapter, I want us to continue our conversation about Marist life and Marist mission here in the USA and in the world. And the word I want us to start talking about is the word consecration. And it came up again last night. And I know it's going to come up again. And in earnest, so we spent a lot of time on the brothers. And still, as people will say, there are still questions. So let's just have a little conversation on that while we're together. And I actually want to reach back about 30 years to begin this conversation. I can go back 200, 36 about. In 1985, Brother Basilio, our Superior General from Mexico, certainly in a time of terrible trouble for the Institute, assessed the Institute, and he recognized our strengths. He talked about our attachment to the spirit of the founder, St. Marcellin. He says, this attachment brings remarkable unity to the Institute and creates a harmony which is deep and enduring. How true. The excitement of the past 30 years as we grew to know more and more of Marcellin and how attractive Marcellin is and the charism is for young people. It's been startling. I think none of us would have guessed that in the past 30 years. Even other groups would say, how is it so popular? It talked about the relationship of brothers to leadership. It was a good strength, he felt. He talked about the caring, simple, and brotherly quality of relationships and community. Agreed? The ability to rise above the negative and impersonal aspects of formation. I think he's talking about old formation. The institution. And at that time, as Ernesto mentioned this morning, our apostolate was almost entirely in educational institutions. It was starting to expand to serve young people at risk, but mostly were schools. And he also noted our fidelity to prayer, especially by the senior members, who were like old oak trees standing against the wind and the tide. Those are the strengths. Yet, our saintly Basilio, and the last time I saw him, he said, Patrick, I'll see you in the United States someday. I love Basilio. He also talked about the challenges we face 30 years ago. One, our poor rhythm of community prayer in many places, especially the increasing trend to opt to pray alone and to attend Mass alone. Brother Wolf. Two, our inauthenticity of personal prayer, too often stifled by the demands of work and attraction to social and political causes. Third, the devaluing by many brothers of our religious consecration. Basilio had the sense that many brothers, many of us, our understanding of consecration was kind of insecure and unstable and immature. He believed it was essential first to follow Christ with total gift of one's life and to be fully integrated into the charism and spirit of the Institute. Consecration has to be focused on Jesus Christ. This is to make Jesus Christ known and loved, and to direct our efforts exclusively to the young, with preference for the underprivileged, and to do this as the mission of the Church has entrusted to us. Now, I couldn't resist quoting another former general on the topic of consecration. He wrote, our way of life was never meant to be predictable. Rather, it was meant to shake us up and stretch us to the limits, to be judged a bit foolish by some, and ultimately, to be a blessing beyond measure to our Church and to our world. Consecrated life, pure and simple, only makes sense if you and I are in love. Do you recognize the words? Can you guess who it is? Consecration. It's all about love. And when I rethought that, something else struck me from a movie that I once saw.
Boulder, do you love me?
Do I what?
Do you love me?
Do I love you? With our daughters getting married and the struggle in the town, you're upset, you're worn out, go inside, go lie down. Maybe it's indigestion.
No, Golden, I'm asking you a question.
We'll leave you out like tonight. How many of us, right? If Jesus were, as he did to Simon Peter directly, after the resurrection, said to us, do you love me? He'd say, what? You what? And he is asking us, he's asking each of us, do you love me? Now, for some of us, we responded to Jesus' call to follow that was first revealed in our baptism. When we made our public vows to follow poor, chaste, and obedient to his word. And we lived in the Institute of the Maris Brothers. And Ernesto pointed out to us earlier today, Mary had her finger in there too, probably, shaping us and calling us into her family. And for others of us, we responded to Jesus' call that we received at baptism, and we identified with the Maris Brothers' life. We try to live as true disciples in the vision of St. Marcellin, building more open and diverse communities to be beacons of light, to be the Marian face of the church and the world. And of course, there's Mary again. She's attracted us and created us to be a family. So while we're here together, as part of our deliberation together, I ask you, what does your consecration mean to you? And how will you live your consecration, our consecration? Whichever way we choose, there are clear criteria and definition for membership as vowed and lay Maris. For me, membership as a Marist of Champagne demands a clear mission to make Jesus Christ and his word known among young people and children, especially those living on the margins of life. Membership demands sharing spirituality, lived in St. Marcellin's example. Membership has the privilege of sharing simple and humble community with those who call themselves Marist as well. You and I, bowed and lay, need to be people of prayer. I told one candidate a long time ago, if you don't pray, you don't stay. He didn't. That's the truth, isn't it? What is the quality of our personal prayer? Our communal prayer? Our public liturgical prayer? Would folks know us even as Marist? Speaking of folks, who are the members of the Marist family in the USA? Are we truly diverse? How do we witness in this fragmented world? Do we see or do we feel the scandal of indifference and the inequality, especially known by so many? Particularly after all the economic and personal benefits that we've received. In most of our lifetimes, our province has been greatly blessed with wonderful financial management and stewardship that have ensured our safety and well-being. I would be remiss if I did not mention any of the planning for Marist life and mission has to include confident, experienced, financial planning for our mission and community. That's got to be there if we're going to do this, even though we're supposed to let go. You have to have that confidence. Frank Pellegrino, our director of finances, Ken Hogan, our province treasurer, the province finance and investments teams led by Richard Van Houten and Ben Lababo. They're comprehensive and they are competent, and we are very grateful for all their work. We've had the great foresight and commitment of two terrific province fundraisers, Paulette Karras and Hugh Turdy, now joined by John Klein, to meet the many needs for province operations and planning and for personnel. But who knows what lies ahead? Lots of things can happen. Trust me, lots of things can and will happen, for sure. However, we still have the question, what's our willingness to share our resources with the Marist family here in the United States and the global Marist family? As we heard this morning in our prayer, when we think about Marist life, we've generally responded very well to our global family and former missions as they needed help. And we must continue to be open to calls here at home and throughout the world for Marist life. Even if we are Abraham and Sarah, we need to continue to be generative. Did you hear me? Even if we are Abraham and Sarah, we need to be generative. We need to seek new members to share our Marist vision and mission. Throughout our recent meetings with the province, at different community meetings, we've heard this over and over again. It's time for conversation about new members. On one level, we look forward, the council look forward to the upcoming Lay Marist Assembly in July to further this conversation and planning. This will be a grace-filled moment for the province, for our lay Marists to embrace and identify their consecration as Marists of Chapani. On other levels, we have to use our best resources to invite new members. We've heard that throughout the province. We heard it last night. Both new members who take public vows in the church and also new members who will be a new generation of Marist of Champagne here in the United States and throughout the world. In the past 3 years, Al Rivera, Maureen Hagen, Matt Fallon have been leaders in our Marist Evangelization team. The team, many members of the team are here as well, who have been very helpful in creating and planning ideas for the province, have offered us wonderful leadership. But new life will demand new vocation ministry, recruitment materials, ideas, social media, and then formation and new community. I speak for all of us in the province when I say thanks to all of you who fostered our vocation and formation programs in the past 3 years. We thank Todd, Dan, Al, Dombisson, and Sean, and Peter, and members of the communities at Our Lady of Grace and St. Barnabas, Marist College of Mission. We are very grateful for your commitment, your sacrifice, and your enthusiasm. Now, looking ahead, that's where we come in. I ask you, does the province have the energy for the necessary investment to a new generation of vocation and formation programs? Are we willing to use our resources for new life? And are some of you, notice I didn't include me, are some of you willing to give yourself to this task? The task to recruit new members is not as easy as it sounds. Let me be a naysayer here, but it's not as easy as it sounds. How receptive do you think younger adults are to the call of the gospel? we're with a lot of young people all the time. How attractive is being a Marist of Champagne to our young adults? How can we make sure that God's call is still being offered for the vowed life and for charismatic lay members? This summer, CMSM is going to host an assembly on the topic Going, Going, Gone, the disaffiliation of young Catholics in the United States. This was a study by the study done by St. Mary's Press. And then this has become now it's trendy. Is that right, Matt? It's trendy in religious circles, right? Why would this be a topic? You and I know why. The study comes at a time when young people more than ever are leaving the church. Even if they've been raised and evangelized in great programs and great schools. Now, whether it's a feeling of being judged by religious leaders who don't know or understand them, or they're being forced by their parents to attend church, or they've witnessed a sexual abuse scandal, or the hypocrisy of church leaders and hierarchy, whatever it is, young people are expressing the desire both to break free from organized religion and of being a part of the community. Although it seems like business as usual to some, interestingly enough, the church is hosting a synod on youth in the next year, as well as a World Day of Youth in Panama, while we, FMS, will host an International Youth Day in Guatemala. So, as young people leave the church, will they still be able to hear a call to be Marist? I think we, the Holy Spirit, and the Marist of Champagne, we have work to do. Let's talk more about our mission. The third call from the General Chapter reminds us that we're all agents of change, bridge builders, messengers of peace, transforming the lives of young people through an education that integrates awakening faith and living by gospel values. And Marist mission has to include, from the chapter, education, evangelizations, our efforts to promote global solidarity, FMSI, our continued effort to promote safe environment and the rights of the child, and encouraging ecological awareness. Vanessa had beautiful prints there today. Mine are not as pretty. But it's the same agenda. And that's quite an agenda, right? That's quite an agenda, both for the Institute, good luck in the next 8 years, you're gonna need 8 years, and also for ourselves in the next 3 years and longer. And I think it's for this chapter and Marist USA to help to prioritize our agenda for the future, both in the election of a new provincial council and also in the time that we spend here, little as it is at this chapter, to talk about what lies ahead for us. What is the mission of the Marist of Champagne in the United States of America? With the resources that we have, what can we continue to do? What's urgent for us? Out of everything we've had, you see, in the past almost 24 hours, what's urgent? Now, our mission here in the United States has been made to make Jesus Christ known and loved among young people and poor children. And we have an extraordinary history of accomplishing this mission through the ownership of schools and assisting in other schools sponsored by other agencies. Our history is very strong, and we're proud of that history, as someone said earlier today. The past 3 years, I'm grateful to Tom Shady, who's been our director of schools, as well as all of you leaders of schools, presidents, principals, school board chairs, members of our very compassionate, committed, and energetic faculties, and administrations, and counselors, and pastoral ministers, and staff. And of course, I'm grateful to our Marist students and families as well, who believe in us and commit themselves to us. So the question has to be asked. As we meet as a chapter, do we, as a chapter, continue to endorse these ministries, especially the ministries we financially own? And to what extent does our support extend? Now, just a few questions, just for an afternoon session. Now, of course, any thinking about Marist life and missions draws into a consideration of our identity with the global family. We are called to think and to act beyond our province. Think globally, act locally. And here we're asked to think often about Arco Norte when we think of global family. Somehow when I think of Arco Norte, when I think of us thinking of Arco Norte, a couple of images come in my mind sometimes. And I see the brothers running on the street, oh my God, no, I don't want to go there. I don't understand, I don't speak the language. The first scene, by the way, was a little French cafe in Quebec. I saw some people going, I like the Quebec. But remember, they speak Francais là-bas. On parle Francais là-bas. And sometimes I think we get caught in those images of Arco Norte. But these are part of our new world. Arco Norte is also not just the thing we saw there, but it's also Marists of Chapani who are committed to promoting Marist life and mission throughout the Americas. And our most recent regional meeting of provincial leaders and an Arco Norte planning commission, you see, no mariachi, no cafe, there's provincials. And you can see I'm not the chubbiest of them all. Just provincials who are interested in promoting Marist life and mission in a region that we want to promote Marist life and mission where there are at least 1,000 brothers, when you add everybody all up. Not to mention the lay folks, and the schools, and the students. Well, it was clear that we're moving patiently and steadily over the next 10 years to find places of collaboration for regional formation, ministry, financial models. Even Frank just returned from Guadalajara and said, it was excellent. He didn't even say excelente. Of course, we recognize our linguistic, cultural, political, and other differences. No one's denying any of that. But by as Marist of Champagne, I think we're energized by the potential of sharing resources and our future life and mission. So, almost long enough, just a few more words. 10 years ago, the 21st General Chapter ended with a little message. The journey started there and continues today. A new beginning began there and continues today. And the message was to different groups, and I'd like to end with these messages. First, to you senior brothers, and you're remarkable. Say that. So that was in the chapter message, but I'm telling you. You're remarkable. Your energy, your commitment. And I know in our world, I'm supposed to be a senior brother. I get into the movies cheap. But I'm not talking about my world. I'm talking about you senior brothers. You know who we're talking about. You've given the best part of your life to the mission of the Institute. Thank you for your fidelity. You have an honored place with us on this journey. And we count on you. Your witness, your presence, your joy, and your prayer. And to you brothers in midlife, and only in the Marist Brothers can midlife be till you're 75. Please continue on the pilgrimage. Don't be afraid of the new ways that lie ahead. Jesus, Mary, Marcelin, and your brothers are walking with you. Time is short. Please go ahead and discover your heart for a new world. To you, our young brothers, those of you under 65, no, our really younger brothers as well, please continue to live in hope and joy for a future where the gift of the sacrifice of your life for God will change the world for children. We count on you, your dynamism, your faith. Yes, the future is in your hands. To you in formation, out in other formations as well, live generously the gift of your life that God is calling you. God is faithful and will love you always. So welcome to our Marist family. To you, our brother and sister lay Marist, who in your heart desire the fullness of your baptism within the charism of Marcelin Champagnat, we welcome you to walk with us together. And to you, our young ones, our young Marist, who dream of a better world. And we pause just thinking of the students who are in Washington today, just to make their opinions known, to stop the violence, stop the craziness. You who dream of a better world, listen to what your heart is, what God is saying to you. And please, please, come with us on this journey.